Now your burden's lifted. Carry far away. Precious blood has washed away the stain.
You're listening to a message presented at New Market Christian Church. We're located at 300 South 3rd Street in New Market, Indiana. We meet for Sunday school at 9 o'clock and for worship at 10 o'clock each Sunday morning. If you do not have a church home, we'd love to invite you to join us here at New Market Christian Church. And now, a message by Dr. Gary Snowden. You know, one of the things I've heard over the years is that preachers just don't talk about hell anymore. Well, I thought I'd fix that today. We're going to have a series about hell over the course of the next few weeks. And the question today is hell really necessary? And there are several scriptures. They're inside your bulletin. They're on the screen, and they'll be up there as we use them throughout the course of the morning. I'd like to begin by making one point extremely clear. If there is no hell, then God isn't a holy and just God. If your child or your wife or your husband had been murdered, you would expect justice to be rendered when they caught the individual who murdered them, would you not? Justice is a part of the requirement of having a just and holy and loving God. Before we go any further, since these are difficult subjects, let's take a moment to go to God in prayer. God, we're going to be looking at the place you tell us was created for the devil and his angels. And we recognize that you said those of us who refuse to accept you will end up there, and those who accept you will end up in heaven. Help us to realize that your justice is real, as well as your love, as well as your mercy and your forgiveness. For it's in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen. Hell is its proof to us that God takes sin seriously. It's not something just to be flippant about. He takes sin seriously. If we appeal to our inner sense of justice, it's all going to make pretty good sense, just like we talked about with someone hurting or killing one of our close loved ones. We expect justice to be meted out. Revelation is pretty effective in laying out this idea of hell. Four times Revelation mentions Hades, or hell if you will, and it alludes to it being a place of power, but it also makes it clear it's also a place of impending doom. So although it may be a place where the devil reigns, God has so much more power, there is no comparison. You know, it would be one thing for someone to say, I am going to make it possible for you to raise from the dead and come live in heaven forever. It'd be one thing to say that. I mean, I could say that, but I wouldn't have the power to carry it out. Here's the thing. Jesus showed himself to be man by allowing himself to die on the cross. But he showed himself to be God by raising from the dead and going to prepare a place for us. What he proved is that he has power over death. Jesus proved through his death, burial, and resurrection that he has power over death and he has power over Hades, and no one has to go to hell. Now, by the grace of God, by the blood of Jesus, every last person who has ever lived has had access to freedom from the sting of death and the torment of hell. And what I mean by that is, up until Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, the sacrifices rolled the sins forward in anticipation of the coming Messiah. And it was always been, from the beginning of time, obedient faith is what brought you into a right relationship with God. Remember, he said, show me you love me by obeying me and leaving that one tree alone. We talked about that not too long ago. What we need to understand is that all of those people were looking forward to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, his blood for their forgiveness. And now we look back on the cross saying, thank you, Jesus, for what you already have done through your death, burial, and resurrection. It's the blood of Jesus who has always saved those who possess an obedient faith in God. If you look at Hebrews chapter 11, it makes that really, really clear. By faith, they lived their lives in obedience to God over and over again. That's what God has always required. Now, when it comes to hell and thinking about what it must be like. How many remember those 105 degree days this summer? Remember those? I was over painting our garage on one of those 105 degree days. Man, it was hot. I'm guessing that if you're anything like me, on those really hot days when you were out doing things, you were thinking to yourself, I'm just not cut out for hell. I actually got done painting that garage. I took my shirt off. I could wring water out of my shirt. That's how hot it was that day. You could literally wring water out of my shirt. I read a saying this week, and it sums it up pretty well, but I'm telling you up front, my wife ain't gonna like it. Here goes. Usually when she doesn't like something, I know she's gonna like it, I shouldn't do it, but every now and then I just got to anyway. Here goes. Spring has sprung, fall has fell, summer is here, and it's hotter than usual. It's funny, isn't it, how we try to leave off the obvious. You know, we don't even like to say the word hell. We come up with things like, you know, H-E double hockey sticks. You ever heard that? We don't even like to say the word. Nobody wants to think about hell. But you know who spoke about hell more than anyone else in the Bible? It was Jesus himself. And I think in large part because he didn't want any of us to go there. He loves us. He wants us to come be with him. Jesus spoke about hell. Unfortunately, we live in a world where people take a food buffet approach to the Bible. Have you ever noticed that? You know what a food buffet is? They got all kinds of things out there. You go down through there. If you like it, you take some of it. If you don't like it, you leave it there. And that's the way they treat the Bible. If they like it, they'll take it. If they don't like it, they just leave it there. We load up our plates with the parts of Scripture that talks about God's love and God's mercy and God's grace. But we skip over God's justice because it's uncomfortable. We skip over God's judgment because that's just uncomfortable. We skip over God's wrath because we don't like to think about God being mad about anything. All those things become taboo to us, and we put them off in a distance, and we want to leave those things for the next preacher to come talk about. I'm going to preach on love and joy and peace, and I am not going to deal with that hard subject of hell. I'm going to leave it alone, and somebody else can deal with it. But the fact is, we just can't afford to cherry pick God's word because there is a hell. It exists. When we try to say it doesn't, when we try to just look at God as the God of love and mercy, when that's all we look at, what we're really doing is we're saying, God, I want you to be like me rather than me to be like you. I'm uncomfortable with this whole judgment thing, so let's just leave it out. Let's just talk about your love, and let's just talk about your grace. Let's just talk about your forgiveness. Those are the good things. That's what I want to know about God. And what we're doing is we're really painting an image of what we would like for God to be rather than what God really is. Scripture shares with us two undeniable truths about God. In Exodus chapter 34, verse 7, we read these words. God, I put that in parentheses because it wasn't there, but it's implied by the context. God keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgressions, and sin, yet he will by no means leave the guilty unpunished. So God is forgiving. God is loving, but he will not let the guilty go unpunished. And that, my friends, is why there is a hell. With no contradiction and with no apology, God reveals himself as both forgiving and just. And we need to see him that way. Part of his justice includes a hell that's hot. It's a creepy place. My wife says, "Are you going to be anything scary?" I said, "Not this week, but give me a chance." Hell is reserved for those who refuse to respond to God's revelation. He says, I want you to love me and show your love through obedience. But here's the thing that we need to ask ourselves. Is hell really necessary? I mean, couldn't God just forgive everybody all their sins, usher them into heaven, and not have to worry about it? He's God, after all. Can he just do that? Let's think about that for a moment. How can we harmonize the idea of a God of infinite love, allowing a place of torment like this? I mean, how can we rationalize that? How can we make our minds understand that? Such a glaring assumed, get the word assumed, such a glaring assumed contradiction tends to leave a bad taste in our mouths. How could loving God let somebody go to hell where worms never die, where fire burns, and where it's dark, and where God isn't? You see, human beings don't want to think about that. They just want to see the God of love. Oh, he loves me so much. He'll forgive me. It doesn't matter what I do. Friends, heaven is a monument to God's grace. And hell is a monument to his justice. Hell is a monument to God's absolute justice. And we're going to talk about that in a week or two. Right now, though, we want to focus on this question. Is hell really necessary? Can we have heaven without hell and God still be just? Matthew 25, verse 46 puts it this way. It lays it out there and it says both are there. He says, and these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. In essence, both places exist. Both are part of God's plan. I think the real issue, the thing that makes us so uncomfortable is our misunderstanding of how people get from where they are into the pit of hell. I mean, we got this picture of this judge up there with a giant gavel. I like that one. Send him to heaven. I don't like that one. Send him to hell. I like that one. I like that one. I like that. They can go to heaven, but not that one. If I'm pointing to you, it was by accident. It's like nothing intended there. That's not the way it works, guys. Sending someone to hell is not something God takes joy in. His desire is that all men will come to repentance. He wants every last one of us to enjoy the blessings of salvation and eternity with him. That's God's desire. But God's not going to force someone to live with him in heaven forever if they don't want to be there. You see, hell is a decision, not just a destination. If God sentences someone to hell, it's because, now listen carefully, it's because that person chose that destination. They chose to go there. Every day, someone refuses to respond to God's grace. They're crying out, God, I don't want to come to heaven to live with you. When you're rejecting God's grace, you're saying, God, I want to live like the devil, enjoy all that this world has to offer. We're just saying, God, I don't believe hell's really there. I don't believe it's really real. I don't believe it really affects me. He says, God, I think if I just have to choose, I'm going to enjoy this life, and if I've got to go to HC double hockey sticks, I'll deal with it then. There's a lot of people that feel that way. They just kind of shrug it off. There's no missing God's message of hope of salvation. He reveals himself to us in three different ways. Now, I know that the Word of God is the big one, so I'm going to save it for later, but right now I want you to know that he reveals himself to us in three different ways. One way is he reveals himself to us through his creation. Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 25 puts it this way. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. Now he's going to explain how. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, his divine nature have been clearly seen. In essence, look at this creation from the very beginning. It's there. It's crying out, I am here and I love you. Being understood from what has been made so that men are without excuse. There's no excuse. Just look around. There's got to be a God. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over to the sinful desire of their hearts, to sexual impurity, for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served the created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. In essence, creation has been crying out, I'm here, love me. But he goes on, he says, it's also on your conscience. I'm inside of you. I'm working on your conscience. Romans chapter 2, verses 14 to 16 makes that clear. Indeed, when Gentiles who do not have the law do by nature the things required by the law, they are a law for themselves. Even though they do not have the law, the written word, even though they do not have the law, since they show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness, and their thoughts now accusing, now even defending them. This will take place on the day when God will judge men's secret thoughts, secrets through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares. In essence, our insides, our gut, our conscience is constantly telling us we shouldn't kill people. Think about it. Isn't that kind of an obvious thing? Inside yourself, you just know that. Your conscience is telling you, you shouldn't be doing that. It's not right to steal something somebody else has. Your conscience is dealing with that. Heaven is crying out, there is a God. He loves you. Look at how he's cared for you. Your conscience is crying out, there is a God. He expects you to live in a way that you don't harm or hurt others. God is here. Listen to your conscience. Listen to the world around you. And then his word comes into play. And he puts it in black and white. If you look back there in Romans chapter 2, verses 17 to 29, you'll find out that the scripture is there for our understanding. Now you, if you call yourself a Jew, if you rely on the law and brag about your relationship to God, if you know his will and approve of what is superior because you are instructed by the law, if you are convinced that you are a guide for the blind and a light for those who are in the dark, an instructor of the foolish, teacher of infants, because you have the law, the embodiment of knowledge of truth. That's why they were doing this. These Jewish religious rulers said, look, I've got the law, I know what it says, and this is how you ought to live. They were laying it out there. They thought they had it all together, but he went on to tell them, you then who teach others, do you not teach yourself? It's not enough to have it in black and white. It's got to get inside of you. You who preach against stealing, do you steal? You who say that people should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? As it is, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. Man, he lays it out pretty clear. The word is there. And you not only got to read it and know what it says, you got to be willing to do it. Because if not, you become one of the hypocrites he was describing. And those hypocrites wore the title of Pharisee, the title of Sadducee, the doctors of the law, if you will, the learned men of the day, the religious people of the day. They thought they were something special because they knew the law. And Jesus says, au contraire, knowing it and living it are two completely different things. He says, the law is there so you know the truth. Your conscience is there so you understand what I desire. The creation is there to show you that I am God and I am a great big God. This universe is huge just to show you how big I am. That's God's way of saying, here I am. That's God's way of saying, I want you to come live with me. That's God's way of saying, my grace is sufficient for you. He's crying out in so many different ways. He says, I want all of you who will come to me with an obedient faith to come so that we can spend eternity together. Hell is really a choice one makes when he or she decides to reject God's offer of heaven. He says, man, I made it clear through my creation. I made it clear through your gut. I made it clear through my word. I want you to come live with me. I want you to love me. I want you to show that love through your obedience. That's what I want. God sent his son, Jesus, so no one would ever have to go to hell. He sent him to the cross of Calvary to provide a path of salvation to all who will accept his gift of love. But following that path is a choice that each and every one of us is required to make on our own. It's like this. The devil cast a vote for you. He wants you to come live with him forever in hell. God cast a vote for you. He wants you to come live with him forever in heaven. But each one of us cast the deciding vote of where we'll spend eternity. The ultimate choice belongs to each one of us as to whether we're going to go to heaven or whether we're going to hell. It's not a mean, cruel judge up there forcing us into hell. It's us deciding that's where we want to spend eternity. God's desire has always been for mankind to love Him and to show that love through obedience. The only way we can be free to make that kind of a choice, the only way for us to have free will, is if there is an alternative. And there is. There is heaven and there is hell. The alternative is available. We can love God and choose to accept His gift of grace. Or we can have a lack of love for God and choose to reject His gift of grace. That choice will seal our eternal destiny. On judgment day, God will simply say, "Welcome to heaven. Enter into my kingdom. Well done, my good and faithful servant." Or the devil's going to say, "Come on down. I've got to heat it up for you. You make up your own mind which way you want to go." We will have made the decision of who will welcome us into eternity by the choice we made to either accept or reject the grace of Almighty God. So the question, is hell really necessary? Do we need to have freedom to choose? Well, if we didn't, we would just be robots. God wanted us to love Him because we wanted to love Him. And because of that, I can unequivocally say, it is really necessary for there to be a hell. Yes, it's necessary for there to be a hell. It places the choice of loving God or having a lack of love for Him squarely in our court. In that sense, hell is absolutely necessary. But here's the thing, no one is being forced to go there. Each person makes their own choice. God simply acknowledges and allows our choices. If He didn't allow our choices, we would not have free will. That's what makes our relationship with Him so special. God has cast a vote for every person in here today. He wants you to come live with Him forever. But here's the thing. The devil's cast his vote as well. He wants you to come live with Him. Have you cast your vote? Have you given your life to Jesus? If not, there is no better time than now to say, "God, I accept your gift of love." It can't be put much better than God put it in John chapter 3, verse 16. "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." If you're ready to choose heaven, then we encourage you to come just as you are and allow God to make you all He wants you to be. Won't you come as we stand and as we sing, "Just As I Am"? You've been listening to a message presented by Dr. Gary Snowden, minister at New Market Christian Church. We would love to have you come join us as we seek to worship God, love one another, and reach out to our neighbors.